Now for the Commodore 64, videotape training with Commodore's foremost authority, Jim Butterfield.
Hello, I'm Jim Butterfield, and I'd like to tell you about the Commodore 64.
Fourteen exciting sessions on today's hottest-selling home computer. Vital, up-to-date information to inform the novice and intrigue the experienced.
Hello, my name is Jim Butterfield, and I'd like to tell you about the Commodore 64. It's a pretty good computer. It has a lot of features. Very good color, sound, picture, graphics, an excellent keyboard, a huge amount of memory, and the price is certainly right. Let's take a look inside the box and see what we have in here. The first thing you'll see when you open the box is the Commodore 64 itself. That's the whole computer. It looks just like a typewriter keyboard, but it's everything. All we need to do is to connect it up. Let's see what else we have in the box waiting for us. In here we have the Commodore 64 User's Guide. That's a very useful book. You'll need that. Don't throw it away. All sorts of cables and connectors in here. The first and most important is we need to be able to connect power into the computer. We'll do it through this transformer regulator device. But there's more. This cable is to connect from the computer almost to your TV set. In order to complete the connection to your television set, you'll need one more thing, an antenna switch box, and this comes inside the box, too. It has a little switch on it. We'll show you how to use it later. Let's put the box away. And let's just take a look at the connections that you have on the Commodore 64 before we hook it up. First of all, over here we have two what are called control ports. They're used for things like joysticks, paddles, and even specialized things like light pens and so on. Next to this, we have our on-off switch, but that's no good to us until we hook up the power. And the connector next to it, that's where the power goes. Let's go. We have lots more connections, so let's go around the corner here. And here we have what is called the cartridge connector. That's where most of our big things plug in, such as extra memory, large cartridge programs. Next to it, we have a little channel selector. You can select either channel 3 or channel 4, depending on which channel is available in your television viewing area. And here is the connector that will hook up to our TV set. Continuing along there, sometimes you may have something a little classier than the TV set called a monitor. If you do, you don't want this connection. That's called an RF signal. You'll want the one next to it. That's a signal for a monitor called a video signal. We'll talk about that again in a moment. Next to it, this is called the serial bus connector. This one will hook up to devices like floppy disk, like your printer, for example. Notice that one connector hooks up to everything. One connector serves all. But there's still more. The next one is where we connect our cassette tapes, our Commodore data set, as it's called now. This is a device you can use to store programs or data. We'll look at that in a moment, too, but that's where it plugs in. And finally, we have what's called a user port. That can be used for anything you like. But the most common use is for a modem to plug in something for communications to other computers, to other cities. Okay, we finished our tour. Let's plug this machine in. We'll start with our power end. First of all, let's get all of these cables loose. And we'll take the rubber band off here. Okay, here we go. This is quite heavy, so put it on the floor or somewhere convenient. This part plugs into the power connector we mentioned previously. Let's take a look at that, and here we go. Okay, now this part will plug into our power plug in the floor. We'll hook that up a little later. The only thing left now is to hook up our TV set. Here we have quite a long cable. So if you have a big TV set, you can stand well back from it. There's a lot of distance here. Once again, the place we hook it up, on the back, TV sets plug into this connector here called the RF connector, and this is what goes to the TV set itself. But first, the antenna switch box. We plug it in there, and if we want to watch TV, we can hook our antenna there. If for watching TV, we switch over to our antenna. For using the computer, we switch over to computer. Either way, the signal comes in and hooks onto the back of our television set. Here, let's turn our computer around again, and we'll hook things into the back of our TV set on the little screw terminals that you always find there. Okay, and there we go. By the way, there are some sorts of television sets that have an unusual antenna connection. Instead of the two screw connections, you'll find a little, what's called a 75-ohm connection. If you have that, you can buy a little adapter at your television store to do the job on there. Now, that's all we need for our minimum computer setup. The things that come in the box and your home television set. But if you want to, you can spend extra money and you can get a more deluxe version of the 64. You can add things to it. I'd like to talk to about some of those. Let's move over to the desk here and talk about what we have here. First of all, this is not a television set. This is called a monitor. About the only way you can tell the difference is that this one doesn't really have a tuner. You can't select which channel you want to watch because it isn't designed to watch television. Instead, it gets the signal directly from, on the different connector, directly from the Commodore 64, and it plugs into the video connector on the front to give you a much better quality picture. Now, this particular monitor is a Commodore 1701, and besides the regular video connector, there are some extra connections on the back which give you very, very good quality picture. If you have a Commodore 64 and this Commodore video monitor, do try to get a special cable. It doesn't come in the box. Try to get a special cable to hook up to the connections on the back of your TV set. You'll get a much, much better picture, just a marvelous picture. It's well worth the extra trouble to get the cable. Now, a monitor costs extra money because you haven't got one of them sitting around your home all the time, but it does give you a better picture, and there's another advantage, and that is you won't have to fight over who's going to watch the soap operas and who's going to use the computer at any given time. You'll both have your own hookup, and there won't be any conflict there. Let's talk about some of the other things that we connect to a Commodore 64 computer. This is called a data set. It's a type of cassette recorder, and what it contains when we open it up is a conventional cassette tape, very much like the tapes that you'd use for example, recording music. They're identical tapes, but the information on them is not music, it's programs or it's computer data. This is one of the ways of storing programs and data. A different way is to use what's called a floppy disk drive, which is this device over here. This one holds its information, once again magnetically, but on a device which is called a floppy disk. You can hold a great deal of information on a floppy disk, and you can recall it very, very quickly if you want to. But when you have a floppy disk system, you have to pay a fair amount of money. And so if you're economy-minded, you'll probably go over to the cassette. If, on the other hand, you want the deluxe version for storing programs, you'll probably pay extra and go for the disc. It's your choice, and in fact, you can have both. Finally, the only other accessory that we haven't talked about that we have on the table here now is the printer over here. This is used for making a permanent record of things the computer does. After all, you might get a nice report on the screen, but it's very hard to carry away at the end of the day. The screen doesn't carry around quite so easily as a piece of paper. So a printer gives you a way of recording permanently your information, listing out your programs so you can study your programs in your spare time without having to have your computer on, and generally is a very useful accessory. So that's the Commodore 64 as we'd hook it up with some of its accessories. But whether you take the basic unit or whether you add to it, you'll find it's a pretty good machine. We'll talk about it a little bit more in a few moments.
What is a Commodore 64?
I'd like to talk about using the computer, the first steps, but first of all, I'd like to show you what's inside your Commodore 64. You'll never need to go in there. You don't need to give it a lube job every 1,000 miles or anything like that, but you may be curious, and just so you don't have to look in there, I'll show you what's in there in advance. Let me open it up. I've loosened up the screws already, and here goes the keyboard. We'll disconnect the keyboard connection here. That's a tough one. And here comes the pilot light. And now we can see this is the entire computer on one board. Let me show you the parts. Here we have the 6510 microprocessor. That's the part that adds and subtracts and makes decisions. It's the control center of the computer. It's the heart of everything. Over here, these chips are called ROM chips. That's where fixed memory is kept, the memory that gives a computer the style, that makes it behave in the way that it does. The big chips over here are input-output chips, are often called interface-adapted chips, and they're not terribly important to us, except you have to have input and output, or you'll never be able to send your results anywhere. Along the bottom here, these little chips along here are your memory. Remember, we have 64K of RAM in a Commodore 64. And as we come, once again, back in the loop, we have two chips here which are interesting. This one is called a PLA, and without getting too technical about it, it's the traffic director for the entire computer. It hooks up the right pieces of memory to the right things at the right time. Coming over here, this is the sound interface device chip. This is the one that makes the music. And finally, inside this can, we have a circuitry. I'd like to open this one up. Once again, you should never do this. Especially if you have a plan to play the concert piano. Okay, but inside, what we'll see here is, with a little bit of heat seal gunk on it, is a video chip that actually makes a signal that goes to your television set or your monitor. If it goes to the television set, it goes through what's called a modulator in here. But that's really about it. The other little chips in there are just used to connect the pieces together logically. In fact, technicians often call these little chips glue because they stick the rest of the computer together. But that's all there is. There isn't very much. We'll put this one back together, and then we'll go and talk about the keyboard.
Getting started.
Before we start on the details of the keyboard, there's a couple of things on the screen when you first turn on your Commodore 64 that I'd like to discuss. First of all, you'll notice at the top of the screen there's a message that says Commodore 64 Basic V2, 64K RAM system, 38,911 basic bytes free. Now, you might wonder about that. It seems that you have 64K machine, which is 64,000 bytes of memory, and yet you're being told that you have slightly less than 39,000 bytes available. Well, that's really correct. There's nothing wrong with your machine, and there's nothing missing, and you don't have to look for the parts that fell out of the box. It's all there. What happens is that BASIC itself only needs about 39,000 bytes. The extra memory is still there, but it's reserved for other uses. And you'll find that there'll be other things that you can use that memory for. 39,000 is plenty for the average program. Now, the second thing that you'll see on the screen of your computer is a flashing square. That's called a cursor, and it tells you two things. The first thing it says is the computer is waiting for you to type. And the second thing it says is when you type, that's where the character which you type will appear. And as you type, the cursor will move along to the next position so that you'll see wherever it is that the next character will go as you type it, you'll see where that will be. So it's an invitation and it's a location for you. And it's called a cursor. Now let's talk about this keyboard here. We have here that looks very much like a conventional typewriter keyboard. It has all of those letters in the center that you can never find on a typewriter and you're going to have a good time looking for on your 64 computer. At the top you have the numeric characters, similar to on most typewriters. At the bottom is a space bar, and then we have much of the punctuation gathered around it. Now, if I decide to type, I can type a number 457, or if I decide to, I can type a bunch of characters, A, S, D, F, G, H, a very popular word. Okay, and what happens is the characters, as I type them, appear as capital letters. Now, that's quite all right, but I'd like to talk about the next most important key on the keyboard, and that is over here, there's a key marked return. Now, what this key means is really do it. If I press that key, whatever I have just typed, the computer will try to do it. Now, at the moment, I haven't typed anything very sensible on the computer screen, and so if I press return, perhaps the computer might print some error message. It tries to do it and it can't do it. Or perhaps it will do something not very sensible. It's very useful to know that when we have this return key, if we don't want to do something, but just want to go to the next line, you may hold down the shift key here, and then press the return key, and that says, don't do it, just go to the next line. So return says do it, shifted return says, just go to the next line, don't try to do anything that we had there. Now, there are several other important keys here, but the ones that I'd like to just mention briefly in passing is the function keys, which puzzle a lot of Commodore 64 users. They don't seem to do anything, and in fact, at the moment, they really don't do anything. They are there for your programs to recognize. When we write a program or when we obtain a program from other places, that program will often say, press this key for this effect, press this other key for a different effect. And so what we have involved here is these keys are available for you to use. They aren't really doing anything right now. Okay, let's talk about that cursor, that flashing square on the screen. We can move it down by pressing the cursor down key. There it moved a couple of spaces, but if we hold down the key, the cursor will continue to move. We can move it to the right by pressing the cursor right key, or we can hold it down and it will continue to move. By shifting, we can move the cursor up or to the left. And finally, near the top, we have a key which will home the cursor. The key is marked clear home. If we press it, the cursor goes to its home position, the upper left-hand part of the screen. On the other hand, if we hold on shift and press the home key, it now becomes a clear key and we will clear the screen. A very useful thing to do when you've got a lot of junk on the screen and you want to start over. Here we go. We have now cleared the screen on the computer. Now, at the moment, what we've been doing is we've been typing alphabetical letters on the computer. And we notice that we have a shift key. Actually, there are two, one on the left and one on the right. And we hold down the shift key, we're already typing capital letters, so we won't go from small letters to capitals. We're already there. When we hold down the shift key, what we will do is we will type special graphics characters. You'll see them on the front of the key. If I press an A key, for example, holding down the shift, I will see a little spade character. Or if I print the S key holding down the shift, I will see a little heart character. So if you want to write a little program to play card games, there are at least two of your suits. Now, there are other graphics. In fact, there are two graphics drawn on the front of most keys. If you notice that A has a little corner on it, as well as that spade key, we can get that one by pressing the Commodore key. That's the key with a little Commodore logo to the left of the shift key. I'll hold that down, and we'll press that one, and you'll see that the other graphic comes out when I press the A key. So that's the second kind of shift key. Now, let me press the Don't Do It key by holding down Shift and Return, and now let's try something a little bit different, because there's a new feature of the screen that many people don't know about until they stumble across it by accident. If you hold down the Shift key, and while you're holding it down, tap the Commodore key, the screen changes gears, and now instead of uppercase characters and graphics, it now has lowercase characters, small letters, and uppercase characters, big letters, which means that if we want to type in text or sentences or write a letter or things like that, we now have large and small letters, upper and lowercase. So I can now say, Jack and Jill went up the hill or something along that line and put in capital letters wherever I want to. We have that capability. You notice that that wasn't there when we turned the machine on. We did that by holding down the shift key and tapping the Commodore key. We can go back to simple uppercase and graphics by doing it again. Hold down shift, press Commodore, and there we are, back to uppercase and graphics. Okay, let's take a look at some of the specially marked fronts of this keyboard up near the numbers. There are eight keys here from 1 to 8, which are marked with colors. Now, those are the colors that we can type on the computer. For example, at the moment, I'm typing in pale blue. Here are some X's in pale blue. We've seen that sort of thing before. Now, if I hold down the control key, which is a new kind of shift key, if I hold it down and I press, for example, the number 2 key, which is white on the front, here we go. Now you'll see that the cursor is blinking white instead of blinking pale blue. And the next time that I type something, those letters are in white. In fact, they're quite a bit brighter. I can choose many other colors if I want to. For example, there's green here, and we can type things in green, or whatever we want to. You'll see eight colors marked on the front, and holding the control key will give you any of those eight. But you have more than eight colors. You actually have 16. Now, how in the world do you get the rest? Well, you get the rest by, instead of holding down the Commodore key, instead of holding down the control key, which is up here, you hold down the Commodore key, which is down here. And then pressing the same colors will now generate, oops, let's press it correctly, new colors like gray or That's not a very good one, that's black. But we can choose a whole different style of colors. There's a nice gray. Oh, that's our pale blue again. We're back to it again. So we have 16 possible colors we can select simply by using these keys in either the control or the Commodore key to select them. Now, those are the colors of the characters that we type. But there are other colors that we see appearing on the screen. For example, around the edge of the screen there is a border. At the moment it's pale blue. We can change that border to any color we want, but not by pressing a key. Instead, we must give a command to the computer. Here's our first command. We say, change a certain place in memory to whatever I say, and when you change that place in memory, then the computer will change its border color. Now, the place in memory is address 53280. That tells you which part of memory to use. And to change memory, use the command poke. That says change memory. Where do we change what part of memory? Address 53280. That's the place. And finally, what do we put in there? We put a comma. And then, for example, let's change the border of the screen to black. We'll type in a zero for black. That happens to be the color code. Look it up in the book if you need it, and press return, and watch the border, it will turn to black. If we'd rather see the border as white, we could type in the same command again, poke 53280, comma 1. 1 happens to be the code for white in this case. And I'd like to point out that I have put a command in the computer, and now I must say do it. How do I say that? That's the return key. I've typed in the command, do it, and there goes the border to white. Now, that's one part of the screen, the border. There's another part of the screen whose color we can control, and that is the background behind the characters. Remember, we've chosen the colors of the characters individually. There are several color characters on the screen right now, but we can choose a background color. And we do that by changing a different memory location, poke 53281. Once again, these things are in the book. You just have to know that they're there so you can go looking for them. What should we change the background color to? Well, we could change it to black by selecting color code 0 again, and the background goes from blue now to black. So we can control our border, we can control our background color, and of course, we can control the individual colors that we have on the screen. Let me change the background color back to blue, because I think that's a rather nice color, 53281, comma, and that will be code 6 for blue. There we go, we're back to blue again, and now let's talk about the last couple of things on giving commands to the computer. You see, we've given a command, we typed in the command, we finished it, but it didn't do it until we press return. Let me show you a different command, the command print. P-R-I-N-T says print something, and now we can put some maybe mathematical expression behind it, and the computer will do it. We'll say print 3 plus 4, and when we press return, the computer, which is do it, computer says, I know the print command, I know what 3 and 4 is, and the computer prints 7. You can do a lot of arithmetic this way. Once again, it's in the book, but if I want to say 3 times 4, I must use the asterisk. For multiplication, we use the asterisk thing. So 3 times 4 would give us a value of 12. Now, with that sort of thing, remember typing in the command. If you make a mistake, you can back up and correct it, because until you press the return key, the computer isn't going to do it, and then you can make the command go to work for you. Now, next time we'll talk about a program. Programs are collections of commands that we can gather together in the computer's memory, and then we can say to the computer, run this whole collection of commands we have here. We'll talk about programs next time around.
Let's run programs.
You don't have to write your own programs for the Commodore 64. There are lots and lots of programs available of all sorts. There are word processors, there are business programs, games, languages, and all sorts of special activities. Largely the ones that you buy come in 3 forms. First kind of form is in a ROM pack. This game, for example, Seawolf. Inside the package, there's a tiny little ROM pack containing extra memory inside the computer. We plug this in the back, and when we do, the computer becomes a new and different kind of machine. Let's turn the computer off for a moment, which you must do when you're plugging in a ROM pack. After all, you're connecting new circuitry into the computer. We turn it back on again, and instantly the computer has the new images from Seawolf on its screen. As you can see, it didn't take any special commands. The moment we turned it on, the computer knew it was a new machine. The machine had been almost rebuilt by plugging in the ROM pack here. Let's turn this off for a moment. It would be fun to play the game, but we want to talk about the second way that programs can come prepackaged or pre-available for you. If you have a data set, you can get a program on cassette tape. Let's put this cassette tape program into the computer. And in this case, when we turn the computer on, the easiest way to start a cassette program running is to hold down the shift key here and press run stop. Oddly enough, it should be the shift key closest to the run stop. The other one doesn't seem to work so well. So we hold on shift, we tap run stop, and now we see instructions on the screen, press play on tape. Well, here's the data set tape, and we see here's a play button, so we press it, and the computer says okay, and then almost instantly, the screen blanks. This doesn't mean any kind of failure on the computer. It's simply the computer has shut the screen off so that it can watch tape more carefully. In a few seconds, it will have found this program on tape. It says found roots. That's not genealogy, that's square roots. And we press the Commodore key to say, okay, go and get it. So what we have now is, by pressing the Commodore key, the program has loaded itself into the computer, and it has run. Here is a table of square roots from 1 to 20 printed on the screen. The program came from cassette tape, this one here. It's now, however, copied into the memory of the machine. I've taken the tape out. Is the program gone? No, it's still in random access memory. How can I prove it? I'll say run again. R-U-N. The program's still in memory, and when I press the return key to say, let's run it, there goes the program again. There's another table of square roots. So the program, once in memory, can be run many, many times. That's another way that you can get a program into the computer. Let's talk about a third way. Here we have some educational programs put out by Commodore, and in here we have a program which is on disk. This is a program of educational science programs. Let's plug this one into the disk drive here. We push it in this way, shiny side forward, label towards the back. We push down the little door so that it's securely in place. And now what we have to do is to, I better turn the disk on. Let me do that first of all. Turn the disk on. Now we'll plug this disk in. And now we go over to the computer and say, bring in this program from disk. Now, to do that, we must type in a command called load, L-O-A-D. That always means bring a program into memory, into random access memory, in the disk. Now we have to say, which program? There are many programs on this disk, and we really should say which one. In fact, there's a little pamphlet comes along with this disk telling you what happens to be on this disk. But at the moment, if you don't know, here's a good tip for you. Instead of giving a name, just give a name of an asterisk. So I'll say load, which I've already typed, and then in quotation marks I'll type asterisk to say the first program, whatever it happens to be, and then behind that we'll say comma 8, which means from disk. When we typed it in, it looks correct on the screen, then we can press return, which is to do it, and here comes the program from disk. Now this is quite a large program. It's a fairly big educational program with animation, and so it will take a few seconds to come in. But you'll notice the difference between this and tape. First of all, the screen did not blank. Second of all, I have to give a name. I don't have to on tape, because the tape might just have one program on it, or it will take the first one to come up. But the disk might have dozens of programs, and I often have to say which one. I snuck around it this time by saying the first one, but you often need to know what's on disk and which program to select. You can take it from the information that comes with disk, or in fact, there's a way of asking the disk what's on this particular disk, and you'll get something called a directory or a catalog. Well, the program is now ready from disk, and that's pretty fast for a really big program. And now if we say run, what we see on the screen is the first display saying Commodore Educational Software. Press the space bar. Here we go. We'll press the space bar. And now we're going to begin a program called Boyle's Law. So this has to do with gas pressure. And we'll press the one key, and the computer will say, Well, it draws a little picture of an amount of air trapped by a piston, okay? Give us instructions, tell us what we want to do, ask us what we want to do next. We'll press the space bar, it will ask us to set the pressure, but for the moment, we don't want to run this thing. Our objective here is not to learn about Boyle's Law, but to learn about how we load programs, so we'll say, we don't want to do that, we'd rather quit, and we'll take option four that says, give up. And then, whoops, type it in again. There we go. I was typing too fast. And the program is over. Now, just because I've stopped the program doesn't mean it's lost from memory. Let me review again. Except for cartridges, which start to run almost immediately you put them in, there are two steps in making a program go. First, bringing it in. That calls for a load command, L-O-A-D. And secondly, once it's in, saying run. That is a command which says, whatever has arrived in memory, do it. Do this collection of instructions called a program. Now, we've stopped the program to show Boyle's Law, but we could do it again. We could say, run. And since the program is still in memory, just because it stopped doesn't mean it's gone away. If I press run and do it again, as I did with the cassette tape program, do you remember Roots? The program will run again, and we'll get the same titling back. Now, apart from the programs that you can get commercially, you can also get programs in this form, on disc, on cassette tape, from other sources, from clubs and from friends and from users. Many programs are generally available, are public domain. You won't have any problem getting them, but there are other sources you can go to if you want programs. For example, there are many books containing programs. If we pick up books here, we'll find that there are all sorts of programs for doing various things typed into the computer, and we could type in these program instructions and the program would run. Similarly, even the Commodore 64 user's guide, the one that comes packed in the box, contains programs that we may type into the computer and gives us examples of how we can make certain things happen. Let's see if we can find one here. Here's a program, for example, down this one. If we type in these instructions, then, and say run, we'll have a program in our computer. In fact, we have plenty of books of this sort, and we also have many magazines, some are published monthly, some not quite so often, which contain many, many programs for various things. All of these magazines are published with plenty of programs, and we can take these various magazines, put in the programs, and eventually we'll have a running program by typing these in. Now, one thing I'd like to point out to you, however, is these programs are pretty big. If you take a program like this one, for example, which is for the 64, it starts on this page and then continues through all of these pages through. You can see that's a lot of typing. Now, it's probably a very good game program, so you'll probably have quite a good time playing the game once you've typed it all in. But typing in that huge amount of material means a couple of problems. First of all, a lot of rather careful work. And secondly, possibly a couple of mistakes that you'll have to look for and correct if the program doesn't run correctly. Now, that's okay. It's a good game. You spend a lot of time. You type it in. You run it. You say, what a wonderful game. But if you shut the computer off, the program's gone. There's nothing left. And the next time you turn your computer on, the next day or the next week or whatever, and you want to do that program again, guess what? You'd have to type it all in again. Well, you don't have to. There's a way, once you have typed or entered a program into the computer, and once it's ready and running reasonably well, you can then copy it onto cassette tape or onto floppy disk, and then bring the program back anytime you want to. We call that copying save. In other words, we can tell the computer, once a program is ready, save that program onto cassette tape, save that program onto floppy disk, and the program will be there. And well, then we won't have to type it in the next time. We can just call it up from where we have placed it in storage. Now, there's one other way you can get a program, apart from buying it, getting it on disc or tape, or typing it in from a magazine. And that is, you can write a program yourself. But to do that, we'll have to talk a little more about what a program really is. And we'll do that next time.
What makes programs work?
In order to use a computer effectively, it's useful to know how a program works. That's what we'll talk about here. You may recall that previously we looked at entering in direct commands into the computer. For example, I could say, print 33 plus 44, and the computer would reply 77. That's called a direct command. We could put exactly the same type of command into a program, in which case we would call it a statement, and it would be stored and used later, not used right away. So here's what we might do. In order to store a command, we put a number in front of it. I might put a number here, 100, and then behind it, the same command, print 33 plus 44. And when I press return, the computer, instead of performing the command, will store it away, and then we can use it at a later time. Command, we didn't print the answer now, the instruction is stored. Now, if you want to enter a program, you have to be careful, first of all, that any old programs you have in there are disposed of. You don't want them sitting around. You want to start with an absolutely fresh computer, so you say, wipe out the old programs by typing in the word new, N-E-W. Now we're ready to type in the instructions of our own program. We're using a simple language which is called BASIC. BASIC has simple commands such as print, input. We've seen some of them before. You'll find many of them in the Commodore 65 user's guide. Now, let's take a look at why we would store commands. Why don't we just type the command in and get the work done right away? Well, it turns out that when you gather commands together into the computer's memory as a program, some brand new things start happening that you don't get with direct commands. These basic statements can work together in a brand new way. There are, of course, always the commands that do things, the commands that print, the commands that calculate, and so on. But there are some new kinds of commands. For example, there's one set of commands that's good for creating repetition, so we can do something over and over again. Here's the idea. Once we've stored a command into the computer's memory, we can do it as many times as we want. Hundreds of times, we don't have to put it in again. If we can only bring in repetition, what some people call looping, because the program goes back and repeats again, then we can use that program statement over and over again and save a lot of work. Second thing that we have here is the ability to use some instructions and not use others. Let me give you an example. Suppose that we're printing out a large number of customer bills, and we have written into our program to say, print on the bill, your bill is now overdue, please pay promptly. Now, we don't want to use that communication every time. There are some communications, there are some customers who will have their bills up to date, and you don't want to print that message. So here's what we need in the computer. We need decision. We can decide, yes, we'll perform this activity, or no, we'll skip over it and go on to the next part. So here are the three parts. First of all, the action part, the part that does things. Second of all, the repetition part, the part that goes back and does the same thing for the next customer or the next item of information. And thirdly, the decision part, saying, in some cases, perform this piece of these set of instructions. In other cases, don't. Skip them. Now, with all of those, we can have the flexibility we need in our computer. Now, there's one more thing that's useful to know when we're talking about how a computer handles information, and that is variables. Suppose we have some calculation we want to do, but when we write the program, we won't know what the numbers are. We won't know what the sales results are until they come in, and we're writing the program beforehand. We won't know the customer's name because the customer might not walk in until a month after we finish writing the program. So what we have to do in the program is we have to leave blanks in the program and say, we'll fill these blanks in later. And we can tell the program to work on these blanks and make all of this stuff work at the time. Now, these blanks are called variables. In BASIC, anything that we give a name to is a variable. For example, I can say X equals 123, and when I press return to say, do that calculation, the variable called X will be stored somewhere in the computer's memory, and it will hold a value of 123. But any time later, we can say to the computer, print X, and the computer will look in its memory, find the variable or the blank we have filled in called X, and print its value, 123. In fact, we can do more than that. We could say print X plus 100, And when the computer goes into its memory, it will print 223. It fetched the value of X and then performed the rest of the arithmetic. These variables, these things to be filled in later, are very important. If we didn't have them, the computer would always have to calculate on the same numbers every time. But there's more than numbers, there are also names. We can store names and addresses and codes and anything we want to in a non-numeric fashion. We call this kind of thing a string variable. Let me show you one. If I say X with a dollar sign behind it, what I mean is this is not a conventional variable for use in arithmetic, it's not a number. Instead, we have a name. Okay, let's take a look. We say X string equals, well, we can put in a name, Jim Butterfield. And once again, when I press return, the computer will say, okay, I'm now holding a filled-in blank area called X string, and filled into that space is a name, Jim Butterfield. Now, these things work together with the blanks that we can fill in called variables and with the control features that we have, the repetition and the decision. We can write a program to do almost anything. In a moment, we'll talk about how we can fill programs into the computer.
Putting programs to work.
If you want to enter programs into the computer, either because you write them yourself or because you read them from a magazine or a book, then there's a few things that would be useful for you to know. As you know, you're going to put in your program lines starting with a line number. That's a number ahead of the line which says, don't do this now, save it, and we'll do it later. For example, we could say, I've given statement here, and we could type it in, and when we press return, that would be the end of it. Now, what happens if you make a mistake? Well, the easiest thing, if you haven't pressed return, if a line isn't in yet, then you can use the delete key and go back, and you won't have to worry about the mistake. It will never have been entered into the computer. Okay, now we can finish this line, and when it's finished, then we press return. Now the line's in the computer, and if we have a mistake on it now, there are several things we can do. First of all, if you see anything wrong with a line that you've typed in, all you have to do is to type the line in again, correct it. If I put it in again, the moment I press return, the old line is removed and the new line that I've typed in will replace it. It recognizes that that's a line to be replaced because it carries the same number. The old line 100 is gone, the new one is there. In a moment, we'll talk about what happens if you miss out a line, but here's something that's very useful. Since you often forget to put a couple of things at the beginning of your program, it's usually fairly good to start with a moderately high line number, like 100. And since you may omit things that you need to do within your program, you should skip the numbers along, perhaps 10 at a time, starting at 100, going through 110, and so on. Let's type some more material in here. We'll type. Okay. Now, somewhere along this line, we say, okay, we've typed in a program line, we've made a mistake, there's something the matter with it. Another thing we can do rather than typing over is we can go back and we can type in a correction right on the screen. And even though we haven't typed in the whole line, pressing return enters the whole line all over again. So that when we make a mistake, we can correct it right on the screen without having to type the entire line. This is called screen editing. It's a very useful feature of the thing. So we'll enter some more lines, and I will say, print. Okay, we've entered several lines into our program. At any time, we can look at what we have entered by saying list, L-I-S-T, and we'll see a list of the lines we've put in. Remember, before you start, you should say new to clear the computer of any old lines that are in there. Now, if I decide I want to insert a line that I've missed in between, say, a couple of lines that are already on there, all I have to do is to pick a line number that's in between. To put a line between 110 and 115, for example, 110 and 120, I'll enter a line 115. and the new line will take its place and the old lines will move over to make room. One last thing, if for some reason you have a line of coding in there which is wrong, or you simply want to take out entirely, you can remove any line by typing in its line number and typing nothing behind it, just return. So if we don't want line 120, we type in 120 and then press return, and that line is gone. Once again, at any time, we can list. Now, if this is our final program, there are several things that we can do. If the program is ready now, this is not a very big one, we can say run, and the program will run. That's a pretty short program and doesn't do anything terribly exciting. If we'd like to take away a copy of our program for study, and we have a printer, we can transfer a listing of that program to the printer. How to do it is in the book and in the printer guide. It's a rather curious series of statements where we have to first of all make a connection to the printer, and then we say, let's divert all of the things that would normally go to the screen, we'll divert them over to the printer instead. And now that we're ready, we'll say list, and instead of listing to the screen, the computer will list to the printer. Here we go. And there's our program on the printer. We can tear it off, take it away, study it, and decide what we want to do next. If you ever do this, you should terminate this procedure with a print number 4 that disconnects the printer. Now, as well as doing that, once we have this program ready, we'll probably want to keep it so that the next time around, we don't have to type it in again. Here's how we do it. On cassette tape, we say the word save. By itself, that would be enough. But we can do more. We can give it a name. I'll call this program Hi There, so we'll say save, in quotation marks, Hi There, and the moment that I press return, I get the instruction press record and play on the tape. The cassette tape is already inside the machine, so I'll press record and play, and the screen blanks, which is what always happens when we're reading or writing tape. In a few moments, this is a fairly short program, so in 15 seconds or so, the tape will stop and the screen will return to us, and then we'll talk about doing exactly the same thing when we save this thing onto disk. Okay, the program is saved. I'll simply stop the cassette tape here, and now we'll take a disk, place it in the disk file, and we'll do exactly the same thing, making a copy of this program to disk. We type in almost the same command. This time we must have a name. Everything going onto disk must have a name because we can save so many things on disk. And so we say save Hi There, but we also have to say one more thing, comma 8. 8 is the device number of the disk. When we want to save to the disk, we say save program name, comma 8, and out it goes. I'll press return, the disk will start to spin, the light will come on, the program is being written, and now the process is complete. It was a lot faster than on cassette tape, but of course that's one of the things that you get when you buy a floppy disk. Next time we'll talk about how programs can store data on disk or tape for you. This is storing data. We've seen how to store programs. Now we'll take a look at the next step.
Storing information.
This time I'd like to talk about how we store data so that we can use it later. We'll normally store it on floppy disk or cassette tape. There's an interesting difference between programs stored on disk and tape and data stored the same way. Programs tend to remain about the same. Once you've written a program, it shouldn't need changing unless you find there's a mistake in it or there's some change in your practice in doing whatever it is that you're doing and you need to keep a new kind of information. But your data files will be changing all the time as customers come and go, as they pay their accounts, as they charge new things, or as you add to your record library or whatever you're keeping track of. Your data files will be changing all the time. That's what they're there for. Okay? But they can be kept in exactly the same way as we keep programs on this sort of stuff. Now, I'd like to talk about the general setup of information stored on there. It's not just a formless mass of information. It's arranged in a certain way. If you looked inside a filing cabinet, you could probably pull out one of those filing folders and you would call what you had there a file, and that's what we call these things on the computer. Collections of information are called files, but they do have a certain structure. If you open up your filing folders, you would see a number of sheets, each dealing with a certain sort of thing. It might deal with a student, it might deal with a customer, it might deal with a sale, it might deal with a book in your library. And what we call those is we say, well, I have a record on this book, and I'm going to put a record in here about this new book that I just bought. We call these items of information about a certain thing records, and that's exactly what we call them on the computer. Each file contains a number of records, information about things. Within each record, we have a lot of detail. Some of the detail is constant, some of it changes. We have, for example, a person's name, a person's age, their customer balance, whatever it is, and so on. And some of these fields are relatively constant. They hardly ever change. For example, a customer's name doesn't change much. A customer's age doesn't change until they start getting past 50. Then it starts, the birth date starts moving back a little bit, or moving up a little bit. But in any case, we have fairly fixed information, and we also have variable information. As they purchase things, as they pay their accounts, some of these other fields change quite rapidly. Each of these fields then come together to make up a record, a unit of information on certain things. We may have a lot of records in the database or only a few. I suppose if you set up a file on the LPs that you have in your stereo system, then you'd call these things about records, but whatever they are, you'll have one for each one of the items you're logging. They come together to make a file. Now, there's one more level. If you have a collection of files that work together, for example, you have a group of sales transactions. Excuse me. You have a bunch of sales transactions which are on one particular file, and on a different file, you have customer names and addresses. When you want to process those, you might be bringing in the sales transactions here and bringing in the customer names and addresses and making them work together to print bills or whatever you're trying to put together. Now, when files work together, we usually call that arrangement a database. We'll be talking here about sequential files. And we'll be putting some of these into our computer. We can put those onto disk, we can put those onto tape, and we'll do a simple example of that sort of thing. But one thing I'd like to point out, first of all, is that we write programs, we type them in on the machine, but we don't write files. Programs arrange to write this information on disk or tape, and we give the information to programs. So we write programs, and programs write files. That's generally how it works. Now, let's take a look at a type of file called a sequential file. That's one thing stored behind the other. We can see that's the way it has to happen on cassette tape because the tape reels along, and if you want to put record number 50 in there, it will have to fit behind record number 49. The same is often true of disk. We have sequential files on disk. That means if we want to search for a certain record, we'll have to wade through all of the ones which are in front. That's usually no problem. The computer's pretty fast, and it'll find the record you want without too much trouble. There is a special kind of file available for disk called a relative file. It's somewhat more powerful, but it's somewhat less common. We won't talk about it here in a moment. And by the way, a relative file is not a collection of your cousins and uncles that live in other cities. Let's talk about how we write a file here. I have a program in here which is about to write a file, and I'd like to show you. It's going to write the file on this cassette tape that we have here. We'll close the door so the tape is ready to go. I'll say run for the program. And now the program says, are we ready to start tape? Yes, we are, because the tape's ready to go. And so we'll say yes. This is a program that wants us to give it five names. It will write five names for our bowling league on there. It says press record and play on tape. Yes, we have to do that ourselves. There we go. The screen blanks as it usually does when there's tape activity going. And in a few moments, after the header is written, this is written with the name of the file and says, hey, what's coming behind this point will be a data file. In a moment, the screen comes back and the program continues and it says, enter five names. Well, I suppose we can say the first name will be Bob and the next one will be Carol. The next one might be Ted. The next one might be Alice. And the last name might be Leroy. But the interesting thing here is that while I've been typing in these names, the cassette tape hasn't moved. What happened? I'm typing all of these names. They're being sent to the file and yet we don't hear them on here. Well, what happens is this. That the information isn't written on tape as it's generated, it's collected, and only when you have a certain block of information to make it worth writing tape will you do that. The information is held in a storage area in the computer called a buffer in this case. Now, when I write the last name, then the tape will start to move, and so I'll press return, name number five is in there, and the tape is now moving. You'll notice the screen has blanked once again. And in a few moments, the data will be completed. It will be written on tape. And now it's on our file. Let's stop the tape. Let's rewind it. and take it out for the moment, that data is written here now. Even if I turn off my computer, we can bring it back from that magnetic tape anytime we want to. Okay? It's relatively permanent. Now, let's see if we can read it back in. The computer program said we'd like to rewind it and play back, and I'll say, sure, I want to do that. It says now press play on tape, not play and record. And now it will take a little time. First of all, the cassette tape has to look for the program header. Remember, we wrote a header with the name of that data file on it. And after that, it will then go for the block that contains the data, bring it back, and print it on the screen. Okay, we've just finished going by the header. In another 7 or 8 seconds or so, we will have our data back from that cassette tape. And here it is, Bob Carroll, Ted Allison, Leroy. We have stored it on tape. We have brought it back successfully. Once again, we'll stop and rewind the tape. Okay, what have we found out from that? Well, that we can write information quite successfully to a cassette tape. We can do almost exactly the same thing to disk. This is a data file. It is no longer a program file, but it writes in approximately the same way. We should keep very closely in mind what we have going here in terms of the structure of a file. In this case, we have only one field inside the record, just a name, and that's each record. This could be our bowling team. If, for example, Ted decided to opt out, we could replace that name and write a new file and so on, because files are made to be changed as are needed. That's enough about file for the moment. Next thing I'd like to talk about is a Commodore 64 used as a tool for education and learning.